We ready?
How are y'all? Welcome.
Think about that. I think he didn't say, I think he said he wasn't going to change mine, so there's nothing I can do about it.
Hi, Nydia.
What's that? He said he raised the rates significantly, so I think maybe the county rate doesn't allow him to turn up. You see, that's all right, lots of the maybe state used to get the raises.
Hello, Jim.
Just because.
I'd like to call to order Tuesday, April 10th, 2 p.m. Forsyth County Board of Commissioners work session. At this time, stand if you're able for the invocation and pledge. Dear Heavenly Father, as always, thank you for looking down on this great county and the people who live here, and for your guidance, which you've shown, allowed us to see over the years, for all the boards that have come before. Please continue to guide us and allow us to work together to make decisions in the best interest of the county. Please look after those who put their lives in harm's way for us, both domestically and abroad. In your holy name we pray, amen.
Amen. Amen. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, this is the time to adopt the agenda. Are there any changes to the agenda?
Item number six.
Yes.
I would like to request, if I can get a second, to call a special call meeting Thursday morning. We need just about another day to get this tidied up. I think we're 98% home.
I think so too, and I'll second that, only I'd like to see it Thursday afternoon.
Oh, let me check.
We can do that. We have a finance committee meeting?
Yeah,
this Thursday.
We get 3 o'clock.
We do, sir.
We could do this 1:30 or 2. Or move the finance meeting.
I have a transportation and air quality committee meeting.
That's at 10.
At 10 a.m. What time are you calling for? 2?
I was going to say 2 real time. We can move the finance to 4.
We can. We have to do it pretty quickly. It's been advertised.
No. Can we just meet at 2?
Then we meet at 4.
Thursday at 2?
Let's meet at 2, and if we're not done, we'll adjourn recess to go into finance and come back out.
Okay.
We can do that, right?
And then we can recess finance.
Okay. Yes.
And come back to work session and
still
go back
all
to finance.
Kinds of recess.
It's
my favorite part.
I love recess.
I'm going to be back here by 2.
You can give me your proxy out there.
Thank you. Oh, you go downtown? I'll just have to be back here by 2, if that's what we decide to do.
So
we
have.
The
question is to postpone and call for a special call work session on Thursday, 2 p.m.
April 12th.
Regarding water.
Item number six. And do we want to put item number, whatever it is, Seven, perhaps, and what is the one from Thursday?
That's not till next month.
Oh, okay.
Why don't we...
Well, I don't know why we can't go forward with number seven today.
Let's just take number six, number right now.
Okay, we have a motion and a second.
Mr. Chairman, before we take a vote, I'll give my written statement into record.
Yes, sir.
This is statement P. Davis on record with respect to the city-county water contracts. I have given the allegations I have with respect to the city water. I have given the allegations that I have a conflict of interest, considerable thought since it was discussed last Thursday night. While I maintain my position that I do not have a conflict of interest, I believe the water contract issue is too important an issue to leave this outcome to chance, or for me to take an official action on the contract and then find the county on the other side of a lawsuit, a needless lawsuit, that seems to undo the county's decision. Therefore, in an effort to ensure that I've done everything within my power to provide the public confidence that I can legitimately take action on these very important issues, I wish to announce that in the next couple of days, I will deliver to the Forsyth County Board of Ethics a request for an advisory opinion. The question is the Board of Ethics to issue a determination as to whether a conflict of interest either disqualifies me for the existing water contract issue. And until the Board of Ethics reaches a decision, I will conditionally and temporarily recuse myself from taking any action on the water contracts. When the Board of Ethics renders an advisory opinion, I will then conduct myself in a manner consistent with this decision. It's my statement, and I would recuse myself on any vote on water today.
Thank you.
Any vote on postponing the meeting, the special call meeting?
In light of that, I would request you not do that.
Okay, that's right.
Thank you.
So we have a motion.
Okay, we have a motion on the table and a second to postpone this item to a special called work and create or have and advertise a special called work session for 2 p.m. this Thursday, in which this will be then discussed.
Be the only agenda.
And we have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion on this item? If not, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. There are none. With Commissioner Amos conditionally recusing himself, and I should have said at the outset, all commissioners are here today. Continuing on, changes to the agenda, which I think we had started talking about item number seven.
I'd like to move that to Thursday as well. After item number six.
Is that a second?
Yes, second.
We have a motion and a second.
Mr. Chairman, before I will recuse myself from any vote.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion to postpone this item now and move it to the work session on Thursday? That's the motion as I understand it, special call work session. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign, aye. That passes 3-1 with Commissioner Amos conditionally recusing himself on water discussion. Any other changes to the agenda?
Let me just look there, Mr. Chairman.
Sure.
There was another item about
No, well, if Ken's ready to present it, we postponed it a couple times. I guess that sewer reservation, are we ready to go forward?
Not a mate. I was going to make a request that we postpone that for a month.
Which one?
I made number eight. Till May 8th or 22nd.
Let's go ahead and the farther the better. I mean, it keeps getting pushed out.
Most of it delayed. I made to May 22nd.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the postponement. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. That passes unanimously.
Mr. Chairman, I have two more.
Yes, sir.
I'll leave those on for now. I'd like to add, as a time-sensitive item, this would be a new item. This would be a sewer reservation agreement between Forsyth County and Oxford Forsyth Development LLC. Mr. Chairman, this was a matter that we had issued a letter of intent with Oxford back in, I believe it was November
of last year, and we're just now to the point where we actually have a memorialized contract I can bring you. I will go over the details if you'll add it to the agenda. That will take a no less than a four.
Can it go to the end of the agenda?
Yes.
Item 24 as enumerated originally?
Yes, sir. Please.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the item. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. Ken, you said you had another one?
Well, with respect to 16 and 17, those have been postponed before. If you will just continue with the agenda, I don't want to ask you to remove them yet, and when we get there, I will know whether they can go forward or not. So forgive me for not knowing that right now, but I'll know it by the time we get there.
So when we get there, ask if you want to postpone them or something?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, we're ready to present the National Center. Can the initiative present you? Wait for that.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, we have been dealing with the Mashburn versus Forsyth versus Buckhorn litigation for some time, and the board had expressed an interest in initiating a rezoning as part of a settlement. I think it would make sense to go ahead and add that to the agenda, discuss it, because our rules require any county-initiated rezoning to be approved in an open session. Before it even goes to the public hearing process. So in an effort at least to get that ball rolling, could we add Mashburn versus Forsyth County versus Buckhorn as the last enumerated agenda item on the original agenda? And Commissioner Amos, of course, you'll need to recuse from that one as well.
Just for the sake of orderliness, is your motion, does that include the Commissioner Amos part, or is that a comment about them?
That was just a preparatory comment, and,
okay.
And I did not mean to articulate that like a motion.
The motion is to add the item.
Yes, sir.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there is no additional.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
I'd like to accuse myself. Don't get too big hurry now. I'll have to take time. I'd accuse myself in this item. Any vote of discussion? I may leave the room.
Thank you. If there's no further, if there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed, like sign. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos recusing himself from the vote. Any other changes? I don't seem to see anybody wanting to make changes. Doug?
Yes, sir.
If not, do we hear a motion to adopt the agenda as modified?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the item. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. That passes unanimously. And we are items for consideration. Resolution to stagger the term of Board of Tax Assessors. County Attorney, Chief Appraiser.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, thank you. You have in front of you this evening a proposal that we modify the term that is currently being filled of Board of Assessor, a member, Ken Leach. Georgia law anticipates that with respect to Board of Assessor member, five-member board, they are not supposed to have terms at which a full majority of them expire in a single calendar year. They're supposed to be staggered so that no more than maybe two expire in a given calendar year. And Georgia law gives us a lot of flexibility on changing these terms up if that in fact occurs, and it does occur right now. Presently, Mr. Leach's term expires in 2013, and it also expires with two other members. What this resolution would do right here would be to extend his term for one additional year such that it expires 2014. That would give him the functional equivalent of a four-year term one time. After that one-year extension, it will then go back to a three-year term, which will then have them going the way they need to go, so such that there's no majority ending on the same calendar year. So my request would be to adopt this resolution. Georgia law anticipates you're doing this very thing, and that will bring us compliant with Georgia law.
Thank you. So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. That passes unanimously. Item two, update regarding approval of Superior Court judgeship.
Good afternoon, Chairman and Commissioners.
Yes,
unfortunately, Judge Bagley's caught in court, so he has asked me to come to speak on this instead. As y'all know, based on our case count for the Balfour-Site Circuit Superior Court, we qualified for almost four judgeships. And proposed legislation that was introduced by some of our folks in Atlanta has gone through and is now in the budget, proposed budget for 2013, to start January 1, 2013. We are still waiting for Nathan Dale to sign the budget. But at this point, we are looking at getting another Superior Court judgeship beginning January 1st. So with that, we need to prepare. We've already, Court Administration and Superior Court has already worked on their proposed budgets for 2013, anticipating this judgeship, and they've been turned into Finance Committee. But we need to look at space. And so we've come before you today to ask that you appoint possibly Doug Dehrer or a member of his staff, as well as David Thornton and a member of his staff, as well, and myself, to look at the options that we have around the square, or in the current courthouse, or in additional leased space that we currently have, like the Stone Building, to look at the most secure, efficient, cost-effective way to implement this new judgeship prior to the building of our new courthouse.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions? Then I would, Doug, do you have any comments?
I do, just a comment. We have talked about this with Don and with staff. We're prepared to explore the possibilities with the judge and his office. The additional information that would be needed would be for the Finance Committee for developing the preliminary 2013 budget. It would be the cost associated with securing that location. So we would like to move forward as quickly as possible to agree on which offices will be moved and then attempting to secure location so we can input those numbers into the 2013 budget. But we are prepared to move forward with Court Administration on this project.
Do we want to, it was requested to appoint a committee or just appoint you to grab a committee and you handle it?
I will. Public Facilities will work with Don's office.
How many clerks is required, I guess, or necessary to back up the judge?
I can't speak on behalf of Greg Allen for the County Clerk of Court's office. However, there will be the state-paid judge, a state-paid secretary. We are unsure what the legislation has written says about a law clerk, but there would be a law clerk, and that would either be private-paid or state-paid. And there are, it's a ripple effect, so there are additional DAs, possibly pretrial services, and criminal calendar and clerk.
Thank you. Do I hear a motion?
Make a motion that we ask County Manager to work with the courts on finding a location for the potential new judge.
And I'll second that, but for discussion, but it's mostly questions. How do you want whatever Doug determines or finds out to come back to you? Just or you'll be working with him, and so you'll go with maybe look at building A and say this ain't going to work, and building C works out fine, and then you'll bring it back to the board, Doug? Is that how you proceed?
This will actually be for, we can, I don't think the move will take place till 2013.
Right.
So it will be part of the 2013 preliminary budget we're developing now that you'll hear in the upcoming months.
But if you say it's building X, we already know that you've seen building X and you don't have a problem. Judge Bagley and the rest of them.
We'll work that. At some point in the future, you'll see a lease, if in fact we do lease space,
okay,
for that needed space.
Okay, thank you. We have a motion and a second. Are there any other questions or discussion? If not, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. That carries unanimously. Item number three, authorization for the pre-treatment program for water and sewer.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, and Tim Perkins is here as well. I did bring a little bit more information for you. This is basically for them to set up a program to have industries that would discharge items into our wastewater system. So they'd have a permit if it was applicable. And what I'm passing out, our current provider, ESG, handles our contract for our, not only our water, but our wastewater treatment facilities. And they have done this before, have set up programs. And it basically is a questionnaire, a letter. They would look at our business licenses to see who would it be applicable to, go out and see more information. The beginning part, of course, is a little bit more time intensive than once it's in place. In talking with ESG, they are willing to work with us under our current agreement, our current contract with them, and basically just change the scope of services, and there would not be an additional cost at this time. Like I said, they've done this before, so they're willing to work with us on that and help the water and sewer department set up this program. They provide this preliminary information for us to review and for the water and sewer department to review. At that time, once it's set up and it's in place, then we could look at to see if additional staffing would be needed or not. We really think we can absorb it at this time. So I'm very happy. When we asked for this to be put on the agenda, we weren't sure if there was going to be a cost. We were really looking into it because of some issues that were happening within the county. So we're being proactive.
I would, was this brought forward because of a problem, or it's time, or something we've been thinking about, or how did this evolve?
I'll let Tim ask. Yeah, I think it's a combination.
We've been expecting, when we reach a certain milestone, the state will require us to have this program. We're not there yet. When our flow hits, or our permitted flow hits 5 MGD, we'll be required to do it. It's federal rules. The EPA delegates to the EPD. EPD delegates it down to the authorities down to systems.
So
we don't have that yet, but we're getting close, and we have a ongoing problem that has brought this to light, and some issues between Fulton County and their authorities and our authorities that made us look at this, and so to get something in place quickly so we can, we really haven't had any industrial discharges going to any of our facilities, but we've got a current issue, and Fulton has concerns about their ability to come and enforce inside Forsyth County, and that's still being looked at.
I would like to ask, what are we, 5 MGD is the threshold?
Yes.
What are we at now?
I can't tell you our total permitted of all the plants. We're not there yet. They can delegate, they can require it at any time, but haven't yet.
Would it be inappropriate if you were to allow us to postpone this for a couple of weeks? I'd like to look into it a little bit more and talk to you a little more about it. I'm hesitant to add more red tape to our businesses right now.
You know, it's a problem that Tim, the sewer plants need, because you know, they have to monitor anything that goes in that sewer plant, and anything bad can mess our sewer
plant
up.
Actually, too, what we're, without dealing with us, they're going to deal with Fulton.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not, they can't get around it.
I'm not suggesting, but we're going to put every business in the county under this type of program a little earlier than we need to solve one problem. Is there a way that we can solve that one problem without adding this at this point?
It wouldn't put everybody out. It'd just be the new ones when they come in. They fill out a questionnaire and tell us what they're doing, which they have to do anyway.
I'm not against it. Don't think that I'm not supporting, you know, dumping hazard materials down the line. Right now, things are so tough in our businesses, you know, I'm starting to see some rebound. And if it's not time to do it, do we need to do it? And if we've got one problem we're trying to catch, can't we address that one problem instead of implementing a whole new program?
Well,
they could have additional
I don't know that we're approving this program. We're approving setting up the program. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Which means if for some reason it comes back and there are, first of all, therefore, we have time to be looking into it as they set up what they believe the program will be.
I thought a couple of weeks to talk to
them. It's not a real problem.
Investing time and effort into developing the program, that's all.
I'm not opposed to it, I just want time to dig into it.
I appreciate you being proactive also.
Oh, absolutely.
Well, we've been expecting to be required for a few years to do this.
You need to catch them on the front end before it causes a problem.
Yes, you do.
Absolutely.
That's the problem.
Exactly, and we, the one company we did deal with, they don't want to deal with Fulton, and they'd rather deal with us, so. So we can look at this and see what our options are.
I just like to dig into it before we go forward. Cast that over everything.
Well, I would make a motion that we proceed with, or authorize you to proceed with the pre-treatment program. And what will you do once you, will you just implement this program, or you will bring it back for some sort of approval in its final form?
We'd bring it back during your comments.
My name, Mr. Chairman, I believe.
Are you guys okay with the 2-week delay? I mean, I don't want you to put work into it.
Yeah, I mean, that's fine.
With what we've learned today.
I don't want to put you under the gun.
I think 2 weeks is fine.
Okay.
Are you okay with that?
I withdraw my motion.
When we put this on the agenda, we didn't think we had 2 weeks.
I'll make a motion, we put it on the
May 3rd.
May 3rd work session. And then I'll schedule some time to come sit.
April 24.
Okay.
Counselor, is this without?
April 24.
If you want the next work.
The next work session, whatever it is.
April 24. Do we need a vote on this, Counselor?
We don't, but I've seen two commissioners consenting to it right there, so that's fine.
That's a special.
Yeah.
Why is that special?
Who was the second on that? Todd, were you the second?
Second.
Okay, so we don't need a vote on that. Item number four, authorization to proceed with phase 3 and 4, the Fowler reclamation facility.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. This is, as you're aware, we've implemented phases 1 and 2 at the Fowler reclamation facility, and the Water and Sewer Department is ready to move forward with phases 3 and 4, and especially since they're having a new pump station come on. At this time, we had encumbered funds when we opened the plant, when we had built the plant, knowing that this expansion would be happening, and that was in $2,002. We had a price variance agreement inside the contract that was based on the CPIU for that time period. So at this time, we're asking for the funding mechanism so we can move forward with phases 3 and 4. We have the $780,000 that's encumbered. With the CPIU from 2002 until present, it's a 19.23% increase. So really what we're asking for is a total of $929,963 to move forward with phases 3 and 4 at the facility. Thank you.
Dave, is this okay in the budget, or is this do weird things?
We're okay. It costs money,
but
it's been dissipated within their CIP, and we're going to be looking at the entire CIP overall. This is a small item in there, comparatively speaking. So it's okay.
Tim, do you have anything to add to this?
This has been anticipated, like Donna said. This money was set aside for this expansion, and it's just based on the CPI increases over time. This is something we anticipated having done this year for some potential savings with the Lower Big Creek pump station. And so because it was above the original encumbered amount, Doc felt best to come back and get the board's approval for the other. There's still some decisions, some things have to be made on what exactly will take place in 3 and 4. But this is by contract. This is something we're really obligated to do.
Is the principals of ECOM, Nick?
Yeah.
We had discussed, I think, at water and sewer meetings and such about some membrane options and things like that. Do you have anything you want to add to this?
Well, I don't know if it's really part of the agenda, but I can think it's related.
Yeah, and that part of this expansion?
The expansion is, but this time we're just asking for the funding side of it, not the...
When are we addressing that today or not?
I had not planned on it, sir.
We're not addressing the supplier, but
we don't have all of the information back.
Requested.
But can you address some of those things?
Talk about it.
Well, I can.
Well, first of all, what type of information is not back, and what form do you need it in to make you happy with your requirements?
We had asked for some information to justify changing the original contract, and we've had several attempts at this, but we really haven't gotten everything. There's been some recent offers that maybe have been given to AECOM, and then I think recently when we get the letter
out last week. If you don't mind, John and Nick.
Well, wait, I'd like to know what form you need that information.
We asked for a comparison, literally from what we currently have, what the type of membranes that we currently have in the facility, and we asked for specific items in our letter to be compared literally on the table.
They might be prepared to answer those tonight.
Yeah, but I think they want them
right. Well, maybe they have that, I don't know.
They have indicated they will be getting that information to you.
And since you don't have this information, my question to you is, I assume you need this. How can this, therefore, be time-sensitive?
The time-sensitive part is for the funding, to ensure that we have the funding set up for it. I have a feeling the last time this was spoken about the membranes, it was spoke at the Water and Sewer Committee meeting.
Okay. Here's the part that I'm missing. You got the money, mm-hmm. but you don't have the information.
Well, to vary the contract.
Why don't we hear from the principal of the company? Why don't we let him, I mean, he's sitting right here. Why don't we let him answer? He might have answers. He might have it in writing. We don't know what he has.
I didn't say he couldn't address the Board of Commissioners. I did want to know very clearly, very specifically, what it is that the head of our water department feels he needs and that he has not received so far in the form that he wants it in order for him to feel comfortable with it. Now, having said that, I would love to hear from anybody who is qualified to talk about this if the rest of the board is.
I would like to hear what they have to say. This has been going on. We're running out of time to meet the.
Well, that's not our fault if we've asked for
it
in time.
We keep denying it.
Not if we don't have the information.
We just asked for it last week.
Okay.
So, let's hear from Nick and John. John, if you'll.
Commissioner. Chairman and Commissioners, just an overview just to let everybody understand where we stand, and there's a reason why the decision on the expansion of the remaining two trains has not been made. The decision that needs to be made is based on the opportunity to replace all the membranes. We have two trains of membranes. They're 10 years old. They're reaching their effective life. There's a new generation of membranes. There's three vendors that have opportunities to provide that. We were going to have to replace those old membranes with other copies of those old membranes. So what we've done is we've offered to put that investment and our time and our labor into coming up with a system that would give you a brand new, complete new system, restore the asset value of the whole plant, and give you more efficiency, more capacity, that type of thing. So over the last 4 months, we've received a number of offers, a number of embellishments of offers of opportunities to do that expansion. So the decision that we believe the county has to make is to decide on a selected vendor, and then that vendor would be the same vendor we would use for the phase three and four. So we think that decision has to be made first before that the final decision is on the expansion. So we've got three very competent vendors that have given us pricing. And to be honest, they're all very close together in terms of purchase price and our cost to implement. We really believe that this is the county's asset, and the decision to make that, decision on which vendor to use is really gonna be the county's, despite the fact that we have a long-term contract that goes on through 2023. We believe this is your asset. The decision that you make is going to be there for the perpetuity. So we've got three comparable systems. We have, we really don't feel that we should be making that decision. The differential is very close together. One of the vendors does have a few advantages in terms of additional elements that they provide. The Ovivo Kubota system can handle a much higher concentration of wastewater, and therefore you can get more capacity out of the existing system without expanding it. They've also offered to provide, as part of the lease payment over the next 3 years, a drum screening, which would improve the screening facility. So it's additional equipment that they're offering that has to be taken into account. That's not without cost itself, because just delivering that screening, we would have to rework that entire headworks in order to accommodate it. So although we've got three comparable membrane options, there is one that is offering quite a bit more in their offer.
What is the value of the screen if we were to buy it?
The screen itself is over $300,000, and that's on top of the, I mean, that's included in the cost they've offered for the
Except we have to do somebody has to do some.
Right. I mean,
retrofitting, I guess?
Yeah, essentially what we have is a system that takes the water through channels and distributes it at the current hydraulic gradient and goes through the plant through gravity. This would have to be piped up, and the flow would be lifted up to the higher level to go through the screen and then come back down into the channel.
So, look, if I hear you right, it is our decision. You're comfortable that it is our decision. Are you comfortable potentially making a recommendation to us about what our decision ought to be?
Well, this is where I don't want to get in the middle of decisions. There's a lot of opinions, even within the commission and within the department. The department has a stake in this. They're ultimately going to run this. So for us to make a decision, I think is, we can always do it, but I think it's unfair to
the county. What's the lifespan of these membranes, though?
Well, the membranes can last 7 to 10 years, but once you decide to go with one or the other process, you're committed for the rest of the project. I mean, it'll take you another $1 million to convert back to another system. The decision you make will define this plan for the next 20, 30 years.
And apparently, I don't know whether there's a discrepancy or what, but there's some kind of a thing at the moment between the information perhaps that you have or can get and the information that Tim needs and or the time frame.
Well, we're talking about
is this a resolvable problem?
Well, I think what we're going to do, I mean, first of all, none of the vendors has agreed to our terms and conditions. I mean, we have to have a contract with them. We don't really want to sign up all three firms and then select one after the fact. So whichever option you choose, we'd like to go ahead and move ahead with them and make it, develop a contract. We have to do construction work as well.
Your items that you're looking for answered, there's a list of 8 or 10. Is it comparisons between products, or just you need some assurances that there's certain thresholds met, or what?
A little bit of both. It's the existing contract is written around the Xenon, and the dollars that you talked about approving earlier were for a specific product. So we need something to show you that what you're getting meets or exceeds that product, or you'd be able to ask back some money. If you're going to let them go with something half as expensive and half the value, you'd expect to get money back. So we need to give you something that shows the board that by the existing contract, you're getting a betterment.
But we know that Xenon, when they were originally asked for a quotation, once they found out there were some other people in the game, they cut their quote by half.
Let me interject one thing. There is money set aside for membranes, but that was, you gotta remember that, our cost is adjusted, our operations cost every year is adjusted by the CPIU, which is really a cost of living adjustment. It doesn't take into account the changes in import tariffs, the changes in the cost of steel. That's an equipment item. We're being held to the cost of living increase for something that has changed probably almost 30% in cost, but we have a 20% increase.
We've been through this in two or three water and sewer committee meetings, and I can't tell you how many other conversations. Based on what I've heard, it seems like if he can assure you that the specifications are met that you're looking for, that the Kubota product would be a better product, with the, especially now that they're going to give us a 3-year, $400,000 screen. Why don't we go ahead and allow this to move forward as long as they can satisfactorily answer those questions? Meaning, if we were
now, have they made a presentation yet? The $400,000. I mean,
they made it at Water and Sewer Committee.
Yes.
And I mean, we have, there's been a lot of discussion on the Board of Sewer Committee. Mm-hmm. I'm comfortable with making a motion to award or ask them to use the Kubota and get the new screens and all that, provided they satisfactorily answer these questions, because we're 4 months behind schedule.
Will this Kubota system add life to the system?
It'll add life to the system. It'll add capacity to the system.
That's what I want to know, capacity. What do you think will add capacity? How realistic is it?
Well, one thing about
this. Do we have anybody we can ask that's done something similar in an exchange or change up that can verify that?
Well, let me suggest we're getting a brand new system, first of all. So, you know, your asset has now got a new 10-year life. Okay. The Kubota system is a flat plate membrane. It's different than what we've been using, which is hollow fiber. It does allow us to increase the capacity of the existing plant. We can concentrate the waste much greater. I'm not committed to the full value, they think, but it's certainly higher than we can out of a hollow fiber. It's at least 25-30% more. It could be more than that. So we know it has.
I mean, this actually good news, because that has a value to your plant.
Right. Well, that's value to our plant. Right. And the more capacity we can run through it, it helps you, because the capacity, and this is something that I feel we have to address at some point, is not hitting the numbers that we had anticipated when we started this project, because of this, the downturn in the economy. It's not something that's controlled by anybody. I think at some point we're going to have to address that too.
Well, and let me offer that, you know, we're the lowest cost game in town. You're currently paying for every 1,000 gallons we send to Fulton County, $4.03. Our operating costs are about 87 cents per 1,000. So every gallon that you can move towards the Fowler plant, assuming we can get a permit to dispose, dramatically helps you. It's almost dollar per gallon. So if you could move quarter MGD to the plant, you gain $300,000 per year. So each year you save that.
Which would pay for the
which would
new
pay
product,
practically pay. I mean,
pay for its own new product.
Correct. That's we're getting close to that.
I hear the value. I totally understand the value of doing the change up. Just want to know if there's any history of this product and how well it performs. That's all. They have been around a while.
The only thing missing from this discussion, that change out's not free. And so we haven't discussed the extra cost that you'd have to also approve. And that's what we don't have yet. We had a proposal earlier. Things have changed in the last few weeks. Some additional offers have come in. And so we haven't gotten back I couldn't tell you today what this additional change out, what's in the detail of the extra screen, if there's extra cost. So that's what's still missing, is the numbers to lay in front of you.
I would love that kind of everything. But can't you wait 2 weeks for 30 days to get everything?
We're 4 months behind schedule.
I'll be honest. I need a decision from the county to make to go to one vendor or another. I can't be going to all three vendors and getting pricing.
Can you wait 2 weeks or 4 weeks to do this? Or are you
well,
at the deadline?
Well, if you can give me a direction. I mean, anytime. What's holding?
What do we need
to know the cost differential to use the Kubota versus the Z, right?
Well, I'm used to an environment where you do get quotes of some kind from all vendors. So can you just address why you can't ask all three vendors for something?
Well, we would have to give them all our terms and conditions, and they have to reprice everything they've given us. And they've been giving us pricing since December, and they give us new pricing in the last 2 months. We could certainly do that. It's going to take a little bit of time, but we can do it. Right now, our biggest issue is having to negotiate with three firms. I mean, we don't really want to get to that level. Each one's uniquely different. The construction contract we have to do construction on each one. So I'm gonna have to get quotes from a contractor for each one.
Okay, and so I have the relationships right. You guys have been satisfactorily and successfully servicing the county for some time now, is that right?
Correct.
And so what I think I heard from you is from your point of view, based on your expertise, you would like to proceed without contacting or without going with all three of these guys. I think you've been pretty clear, or you've been in contact enough. Maybe that's the way to say it.
I think so. I guess my point is at some point I need to
give them a negotiation package.
You got to go formal.
Yeah, I want to say that we've been directed by the county to proceed with you this far. If we don't come to terms, then it's another.
And that's actually your recommendation about how to proceed. As an expert to the county, that's what you're saying.
That's okay.
And I respect that and would like to try to do that. My personal position would be to support you on that approach as long as these two folks down here are happy with whatever it is they need to be made happy about.
And I need to find out. You need those 10 questions or 12 or whatever. You need that provided.
We've asked for it previously. Right. And this time we just enumerated them very clearly.
So we need to also then understand what any additional cost would be to utilize wet membrane, as well as the retrofit cost for this new screen.
If you do that, and also if you are interested in changing out phases 1 and 2, is what I'm hearing.
Well, I think what I'm hearing is the topic of phase 1 and 2 is on the table, and I guess from staff standpoint, the question that we would have is, does the change out of 1 and 2 along with adding 3 and 4, does that justify the capital modification clause in the contract? If in fact it does, then we may need to let the commissioners know about that clause. So does, in your opinion, does that?
Well, we've offered that we would finance the cost of these membranes over a 3-year period, and that cost would be essentially paid through monthly payments, just increasing our monthly cost. So we would take the responsibility for the contract. The county doesn't have to purchase the equipment. And we, it'd be one sole source opportunity. So we absorb the financing cost, but we distribute your share, the county's share, over a 3-year period.
Well, this is for the bonus system, right?
Well, this is whichever one.
Yes, yeah, right. We got to pick one. You want to pick one system, go
right. Right. And I'm going to give. I would give you a cost.
Well, wait, I don't know what you talked about.
Well, because there are different.
We've had 3 water sewer committees. We talk about these same things.
I understand the closed system gives you extra capacity, which could help come up with the funding to pay you for that 3 years anyways, from what I understand. Because we'll be able to treat more of our plants instead of sending to Ford County.
It's a little bit more than that because there's a lot of transition costs.
Tell me what it is.
Well, and that's what we need to have. It's a little bit more than that. I can't tell you exactly.
That's why you shouldn't. Maybe you shouldn't give them time to.
No, I thought we had. I mean, it's 10%.
Actually,
As I said, until I get them to agree to my terms and conditions, I don't know what those costs
today
are.
Really the first day we've heard AECOM admit that they might be agreeable to the extra capacity from the Kubota. The last time we met, they were uncertain if you'd accept that. So things are evolving.
But how do we, if we don't know what it is until they get into final negotiations, why don't we give them the authority to get into those final negotiations with Kubota and bring it back to us? I mean, if we're not gonna know, we're not gonna know. And at that time, they can also answer these questions. But what we're doing is we continue to delay, and we're 4 months behind schedule already.
Well, won't this make a motion to look at both, pick out a single source to go with?
They go in a second.
Well,
why
do we care that we're 4 months behind schedule?
We just asked for them to recommend. We think it's important that they make a recommendation.
Well, that's a shifting. I mean, I understand that. I think what we're trying to
Well, we've already offered that we'll take full responsibility once that decision is made. We can use any of these things. We're not. Okay, we will stand behind our project.
What I think.
And that you don't have to worry about.
Commissioner Amos said is, why don't we ask that or instruct to move forward with the project with Kubota to answer these questions,
get the
final
numbers.
Calls to
get the numbers,
get into the details with them, because until we tell you to go with, we can't get the final numbers anyway.
That's what
we just
say.
Continue to spin the wheel.
And I was still getting changes even last Friday.
I would make a motion that we give the authorization to proceed with phases 3 and 4 with AECOM and Fowler Wastewater. I'm not going to give an amount yet, but if they bring back a final cost to us and details, I'll say details defined as y'all's the questions that you need answered to feel comfortable. If you're not comfortable, then we will not move forward. But right now, let's get them moving forward.
Well, let me just one more thing. It's very difficult for us to have two different systems. We have to have one system. You said three, four.
I'm sorry, and replace phases one and two with Kubota.
So don't they need a dollar amount? Isn't that what you asked for, Tom?
Well, we were just going forward with phases three and four. We were not pursuing phases one and two at this time.
They won't let you on.
This is a different proposal that's on the table.
We want to place all of the same to increase that capacity. So that phases one and two as well.
Yes.
Second.
And bring it back, when can you bring it back? 2 weeks?
I think so. 2 weeks. I think we can do 2 weeks. We'll plan it. We'll get on right away.
Is that acceptable? Why don't you plan on, if I can, I hate to keep going, why don't you try to get it back to them in a week so that they have a week and then we bring it back to our meeting in 2 weeks?
I think they were struggling with 2 weeks.
Well, that's all right.
Yeah, they struggled with 2 weeks.
We'll do that.
A week to 10 days.
They're not here, but we can do it.
Every 24.
I want to be clear procedurally.
I think there was a motion.
Not for, I didn't make a.
Okay, I heard a second. I want to make sure that you were clear on.
It didn't.
I didn't make a.
Okay.
All right, that was a.
That was a.
That was messy.
I just want.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
I agree with you.
Okay.
No, mine wasn't a motion.
So the motion is to proceed with one, two, three, and four with the Kubota, and then bring back the full details and full specifications to purchasing and the director of water and sewer to then be presented at the next regular work session on board.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. That passes unanimously. Next item.
Sandy, that'll still go on consent. That'll still go on consent.
The next item, Mr. Chair, members.
I believe next item is number five.
Pardon me?
Of an RFP.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. This is for the RFP 1220-3150. And this was for the design work for the intersection at Old Atlanta Road at Caney and Pine Grove Roads. And we sent it to the five pre-qualified firms that the board of commissioners approved. And part of this one is they'll do a traffic safety. It's a safe traffic safety improvement. They'll have to do a traffic study at the area to see if it's either a traffic signal is warranted, turning lanes, or if a roundabout design is determined. We are requesting to award this to Pond, the proposal from Pond and Company in the amount of $67,535. Thank you.
So,
pardon me?
Just so I'm clear.
Yes, sir.
What's before us is to do a study to determine if we're going to have a roundabout or a signal.
Exactly.
Nobody's going to go out there and build a roundabout and then.
No, you would know about it ahead of time.
Good.
We'd like to
try
the way to go.
We'd like to try it.
You know, this
never big enough for school buses.
In this month's Governing Magazine, they do talk about roundabouts all of them.
Big roundabouts.
Bigger ones. School buses can drive around.
Okay, so I'm going to make a motion that we give authorization to accept the proposal from Pond & Company in the amount not to exceed $67,535,000 for the study to determine if a roundabout or a traffic signal is warranted and have the results come back to the Board of Commissioners.
Understood, sir.
Okay.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by.
Just a brief discussion. How long do we think it will take?
Well, the whole design will take about 9 months. So the first study will only be the first couple months, I would say. Is that correct?
Yes. How long before we know if they're going to recommend that?
A couple months.
A red light.
Red light. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
We have a motion. and a second. If there is no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, like sign.
Thank you, gentlemen.
That was passed unanimously. And we are on, if counselor is ready, especially ready for the, I'm sorry, that's the special meeting, my mistake. Number eight, please. Eight is postponed. I didn't have that. Okay, item nine, service delivery strategy update. Senior planner.
Good afternoon. Planning staff has returned. We were last before the board in February, and I just want to recap the meetings we had with the city. We met in mid-January and mid-February and discussed the current services. So what staff has done was we prepared a summary of the services. Currently, there are 32 in all. We discussed those service summaries with the city. We went through some revisions and some back and forth. So those summaries are in your book, in addition to four recommended IGA agreements. Two of those, the fire code permitting is a rewrite of the current resolution of the existing service delivery strategy document. And the annexation procedures and land use compatibility, there's currently an agreement in the existing document, but in order to comply with current state law, the IGA has been revised. We are also recommending that two new IGAs, which are in your book, one for 911 services, the other for EMS, also be included. This was after a careful review with legal staff and as well as discussion with the city. So in essence, what you're looking at in your book would be what we would need to move forward with updating our SDS. We have, once again, a deadline of October 31st for DCA. So what that means is there are a couple of options. We can go ahead and move forward with the update with the service summaries, as you see in your booklet, and hopefully with the IGAs moving forward. The board and the city could also decide to simply sign off on the current document to say it suffices. Whatever the city and the county decide to do, again, we would have to meet our October 31st deadline. So that is where we are. Staff is at the point that we have done all we can do in terms of preparing the document for consideration. And today, planning staff merely wanted to update the board and answer any questions you might have. Well, this part is the easy part. Unfortunately, you have the hard job now of moving it forward and getting the signatures. And once it's signed, the only task left would be to simply put this, upload it to the DCA website, and then it would be complete.
Will we, prior to submission, do we have to hold any public hearings or anything?
There are no public hearings required. You know, at this point, this is, you know, however the city and the county wish to conduct negotiations and so forth. Now, when the document is done, I do have to forward it to DCA. They review it. There's not a formal approval process, but they do want 30 days to look it over, and then they simply, you know, have it on file.
Will we use this type of format, or do we use those forms that are provided by DCA with the procedures?
Luckily, they have streamlined it. It will not look like the current one because that is very antiquated and old. They want everything in a searchable PDF format, so everything literally is uploaded to a system. And so it will be a PDF. It will be a bound document, but it will look much better than
kind of
what
like
you currently have.
Code, I guess, is searchable.
And there would only be one outside of the IGAs that you see. There's only one form to sign. In times past, you had to sign each and every service summary, and the state no longer requires that.
Vanessa, even though we're not asking for any
direction from the board today, would the next step be for this, the board to agree on the IGA requirements and the summaries, and then simply sign off, if you will, on that, and then present that to the city for their sign-off?
That is correct. And, of course, the assumption, of course, is, of course, the water contracts, that is, you know, an IGA that would, although it's not in the document, that would be, you know, part of this update as well.
If you'll offer your opinion, is it your opinion that for the items that are in our book here, that there is enough agreement that you would expect that the county and the city would approve the, what's in here?
Well, what I can share is based on the meetings we had in mid-January and mid-February. I think the service summaries, the city administration appeared to be in agreement that yes, those services are offered the way we described them was true and correct. Now, in terms of signing off on the four new IGAs that are in your book today, I think that will largely hinge on the loss negotiations and working in tandem with that process as to, you know, how the final SDS looks and what IGAs are included, I think are directly related to lost and whatever is negotiated out of that.
Is there any action you wish from the board today?
No, just to consider what we are presenting, and Doug, you might need to help me in terms of if we want to set a future follow-up.
So we email this document first?
Yes.
Well, as Vanessa said, I don't have a date in mind. Vanessa said the SDS and the loss, I think in conversations with the city, may be agreed upon in tandem. And out there, pending also is, as part of the SDS, is the water contract. So, if in fact this board is close to negotiating a water contract, it may be in the next couple of weeks that there could be more serious discussion with regard to loss and SDS.
The only reminder would be, of course, is that the SDS expires. The deadline is October 31st, where lost is later, at the end of December. If we are headed towards perhaps needing to extend our service delivery strategy deadline, the way we would achieve that, the easiest way, is for the county and the city to sign an extension form, which basically says our current document suffices. It gives a 120-day period. You can sign it again for another 120 days. So we, planning staff will be looking at the schedule and seeing where we are. That might be necessary if lost is not negotiated and we still need more time for service delivery.
And just additional information with respect to the October deadline, just be mindful that in order to get to that date, we're looking at a July local government final review and signatures, and August local government adoption via resolution transmittal of the SDS, and then in September mandatory DCA review period. There's a lot of steps to take prior to that October deadline.
Thank you. The way I see this, we should go to item 10 at this point. Cost of utilities relocation.
You want another cost?
Yeah, that's DBD. I can afford that.
On number 10 is approval and execution of project framework agreement for Bethelview Widening Phase 2, which is will be from Castleberry to State Route 20. This agreement was originally approved by the board back in 1999 as an LGPA when the project was from State Route 9 to State Route 20. It was split into two phases, and about a year ago, the board approved a PFA for Phase 1. And now this took us probably about a year and a half to get this PFA here from GDOT and get satisfied with it, present it to the board for approval.
What this does, it just outlines the responsibilities between the state and the county as far as what's required for the project. We've already agreed to, in the original LGBTA back in 1998, to design the project. This agreement really is no different from what was in the original agreement. The county has still agreed to buy the right-of-way. The GDOT is agreeing to reimburse the county for the right-of-way, and GDOT has agreed to fund the construction on the project. This PFA only addresses the PE. GDOT's currently working on a right-of-way agreement that they'll forward to us hopefully within the next month. Our game plan is to get this PFA approved, to get the right-of-way agreement in here approved. GDOT's also got to send us an agreement whereby they'll take Bethelview Phase 2 from Castleberry to State Route 20 as a state route, temporary state route. We get all these things in place by July because in fiscal year 2013, which begins in July, the right-of-way funding will be available for this project, and so we want to be ready, and we're gearing up to start acquiring right-of-way on Bethelview Phase 2 and right-of-way in July.
Overall project and the final building of the project, is that coming out? It's not coming out of two spots, it's separate from it?
Well, it may. It may or may not. Depends on whether it passes.
Okay, two spots does not pass. This project will still go forward.
It will still go forward. The right-of-way funding is state and federal. The county will pay it out, and we'll get reimbursed for it. We'll pay the cost for the acquisition itself and handle that in-house with our staff. There'll be probably over a couple hundred parcels to acquire. There is funding in T-Splice for this project, about $14 million. If T-Splice passes, then $14 million of the construction funding will come from T-Splice. Now, that's not all the construction funding. The total construction funding is estimated at about $26 million. It'll pay for about half of it, because more than likely the construction will end up being closer to $30 million. The right-of-way estimate's a little over $13 million right now. We think it'll come in under that. But that's the funds, state federal funds, that will be available for the acquisition and reimbursement to the county up to, you know, a little over $13 million.
Under this PFA, are you looking for approval of the budget amount for the $2,980,000?
There's no budget to approve in the PFA. It's just approval of the PFA. The right-of-way agreement will come next. And we have Splash 6 funding budgeted for handling the acquisition along with any PE that's required, any utility relocation for the project. We've also got some funding designated in Splash 7 for the utility relocations on this project phase, which we estimate will probably be around $2 million. And the local will be responsible for the utilities, and it will come out of Splash and not water and sewer. So today we just need to get this PFA executed for phase 2, and we'll be back to you as soon as we get a right-of-way agreement.
Make a motion to approve execution of the PFA for PI number 0009316 for the Bethelview Road widening for Castleberry Road, SR20 between the Georgia Department of Transportation and Forsyth County for the phase 2 of the Bethelview project.
We have a motion and a second.
Chairman, I need to add to that. No, he said no. He just wants the PFA approved right now.
Just the PFA approved right now. And just one more thing. Currently, the construction money is programmed in fiscal year 2017. Like I said, the right-of-way is in 2013, so we'll start buying right-of-way. It'll take us probably a year and a half at least to buy all the right-of-way. If TIA passes, it could move the project forward earlier because this would then be a shovel-ready project, and then we just have to get GDOT to move the state and federal funding portion forward as well. But even still, if we acquire right-of-way and certify it in time and TIA doesn't pass, then we'll try to get GDOT to move the project forward sooner than fiscal year 2017.
I believe we have a motion and a Second, if there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. That passes unanimously. And soil erosion fine reduction.
Chairman, members of the board, I think I have some good news on number 11. That one is not ready. Let's go ahead and condenses the agenda. If you would mind postponing that to the next work session.
So moved. Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. That passes unanimously.
And
Mr.
Chairman, item number 12 was addressed at Thursday's regular board meeting, so if we could have a motion to withdraw that one from the agenda, it has been addressed.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. That passes unanimously. Item 13.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, item 13 is a proposed modification to our contract with Veranoisa with respect to the McClure property acquisition. When we purchased that property back in 2009, there were some stipulations that continued past the acquisition date pertaining to how and what we had to do to open the greenway or the park that was going to be adjacent to the river. If you look in your agenda packet, you'll see the 2009 contract, and you'll also see Exhibit B, which has some special stipulations. And of particular importance is special stipulations 1 and 2. We have an obligation. First of all, we acquired the right-of-way to provide basically access to our park, right? Because it was going to be our park. Number 2 says that prior to us formally opening our park as a county park for public use, we had to construct within the right-of-way basically a paved road built to county standards for that purpose. That makes a lot of sense. Of course, we have to make it passable for the motoring public. What is going on now, though, is that the balance of the property that we did not buy is potentially going to be acquired by Ryland for a new subdivision. With respect to our obligation to build this paved road, they may provide a different sort of access to our park. It might even go through the subdivision. It's just unknown right now. We want to go ahead and open our park up, but what we don't want to do is go spend a bunch of money to build a paved road that then we find out didn't need to be paved in the first place and may actually be subject to being reconfigured in some other direction.
I think we were also required to build equestrian fence.
Okay, a fence.
Both sides
right.
of that.
Right. Just getting to that. But yes, we had to build a fence too. So the bottom line is that this made a lot of sense for it's a win-win. This proposed amendment, which has already been approved by the seller, has agreed basically that all we have to do is basically build a gravel road. Just gravel it, which of course is not nearly the expense of the paved road to county standards. No fence. Now it's conditioned upon Ryland closing. Now we can't control that. So but we do want to get our park open. So we would have an obligation under this agreement. We'll build the little gravel road. And assuming that Ryland closes, it's done. We never have to do anything else. And to the extent that Ryland then builds alternative access for us, great. We've saved a lot of money. If the Ryland deal falls through, then we would at some point have an obligation to go back in and pave that road at some future date.
And John, I guess knowing that the gravel that you put in should be appropriate gravel or asphalt, so we don't have to do that twice.
Yes, well, we've got some millings that we'll put on it, but which will be fine as a base. But yeah, any gravel we put on will be suitable for the base of the asphalt.
So, John, if let's assume that not that in any way I want this, but the deal falls through and we do have to pave it. Do we just pave over this gravel, or there's other things that have to be done?
We'll have to do some clearing and grading. Okay. So there'll be some additional construction in addition to just paving and setting up base and do at least 20-foot paving.
I really think the McClures don't want the road paved because they found out that if somebody does buy the property, they're going to want to change where the road goes. So
right.
It makes sense to do it now.
I mean, but And so then that brings me to my next point. To the degree that this does go through and they decide that they want to radically change the routing of the road, are we going to get any money back for not using our road?
Yes.
Or we will?
Yes, we'll have to abandon it and they'll have to pay us back no less than the amount we paid for it.
Well, we're going to put a road in one way or another.
No.
Could be short. We actually paid for it, so they'll have to pay us back.
Okay.
But that'll be worked out through the zoning because they'll have to build a new road and agree to it. We'll have to agree to abandon it, sell it back to them. So all that will be worked out through the zoning process.
All right. Good to me.
So not only do we save the $750,000 to finish the road, not only do we save the $750,000 to change the road, but when they go in there, they'll buy it back from us. That's 7 acres
if
that we paid $50,000 an acre for.
If they reroute.
Well, they will. I mean, somebody will.
Who's the agent?
They want to get something.
And I want to bring you all the attention to the fact that Ryland does have a zoning action before us, but this agreement specifically stipulates that you're not agreeing to anything with respect to their zoning as part of this deal. Thank you very much. Okay.
Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Second.
That's all right. Can somebody state the motion? I don't think Cindy caught it, and I know I did.
I would make a motion to adopt the McClure property contract amendment related to the road construction requirement as presented to us by the county attorney in our book.
We have a motion. Do I hear a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, like sign. That passes unanimously. Item 14. Deputy County Manager.
Gentlemen, you have before you a request from Legacy Link for a local share contribution of $8,450. This is the same contribution that the county has made to Legacy Link for the last 4 years. This money is used to match federal and state dollars for administration, information and referral, employment, and training of older workers, volunteer programs, Medicare prescription insurance counseling, and assistance to all counties.
And it's budgeted?
Yes, sir.
Is it time sensitive?
No, sir, it's not.
Any discussion on this item? If not, I'd like to make a motion that we approve the FY 2013 local share commitment letter required by Legacy Link in the amount not to exceed $8,450.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. That opposed, that passes unanimously. Item 15. Deputy County Manager.
Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, you have before you a contract amendment requested. This is number 2, addendum to the existing contract with Legacy Link. Legacy Link is proposing to us to fund additional units of meals that will allow us to provide these meals to seniors in our community. They will fund us approximately $890. And our cost will be about $903. So there's a net difference of about $4 or so, but it increases the amount of meals that we are able to provide. They essentially are funding almost the entire amount of additional meals that we will serve the seniors. And this is addendum number 2. You may remember we've already had an addendum number 1, and that there is a table provided for you on the back of the April 3rd memo to the chairman that you might want to look at. Any questions?
It says here that we may need a budget adjustment. Does this fall under, does it fall under your authority on the start of the budget?
Right. We can take care of that within the department and to the extent of additional grant funding.
I make a motion that we approve the fiscal year 2012 addendum number two contract between Legacy Link and Forsyth County Nutrition Program Services with contract period of July 2nd, 2011 through June 30th, 2012. On the amount of $9,390 as presented. So.
The only thing, the book I'm looking at says July 1st. You said July 2nd.
On the top of the agenda page. Agenda item says July
1. Okay. We have a motion and a second. Is July 2nd okay, Tim?
Yes, sir. I think that's fine.
Okay. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. This would then be the right-of-way easement.
Are we ready to go on those?
16 and 17, both of those, we do not have documentation back from Sonny yet. Both of those can be postponed, please, to the next work session.
We need a motion?
Yes, you can include both in the same motion.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion for postponement of item 16 and 17 to the next work session.
Thank you.
Well, we have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, like sign. That passes unanimously. Item 18. County manager or deputy?
Mr. Chairman and commissioners, I understand this amendment to the resolution will in fact provide for a slight change in that the 911 director or their designee is appointed to the 911 advisory center board.
That's it.
Yeah.
That's it on the designee.
It's a pretty minor amendment.
The amendment is in the bottom of the offset paragraph where it says, in the event the 911 director is unable to attend these meetings, the assistant 911 director or senior staff will attend in his or her absence.
I thought we already did. We did it at the 911 meeting.
Same item, different meeting. Yes. So moved. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. That passes unanimously. We're on to item 19, permits for charitable solicitation roadways.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, at the last work session where this was discussed, we had talked about the fact that Georgia law allows the county to authorize basically charitable solicitation in right-of-way. But the direction to me was to go back to the sheriff and find out exactly what it was that he was looking for us to accomplish with respect to this initiative, and so I did that. And the main thing that he wanted us to do was to give folks that are soliciting in the right-of-way some sort of discernible identification so we can know that these individuals have at least come in and received a permit and, for lack of a better term, are legit, if you will, that they have demonstrated that they are, in fact, a legitimate charitable organization registered with the state, and they are ostensibly with the authority to be out there on behalf of that organization, which is important. But it's not to otherwise be overreaching. It's simply to say that if someone is out there in the right-of-way seeking money from motorists on the right-of-way, the sheriffs have the ability, the deputies have the ability, code enforcement would have the ability to say, I see your tag, it's displayed prominently on your person, and therefore we know that you have the right to be here. And if you don't have the right to be here, the paragraph that I presented to you, if you don't have that on you, don't have that tag hanging prominently from you, would give the officer the right to issue a warning or to issue a citation in their discretion. So again, not trying to overreach, not trying to make people have to go pay fines,
the officer may very well just say, move along, you know, you don't have your display tag, as soon as you get that, you can come back out. Further, we are not certifying to the safety of what they are doing. You know, getting out and being a pedestrian while vehicles are driving around inherently carries some risk with it. And because we permit you, we're not suggesting to you that therefore we've made it safe. They still have the discretion to go to whatever intersection they want to go to. But if we see you and you don't have that on, then we may ask you to leave. And maybe that might even give the traveling public some confidence that when they're asked to reach for their pocketbook, that they're giving to the cause they think they're giving to.
Will this, Counselor, will this apply to all organizations, or are there some organizations who are allowed by state law to already do this without signing up for anything?
I don't believe there's any state-based carte blanche exemption. Now, we are adding this as an addendum to our solicitation code, and it does have some exceptions in the code. I believe there may be some exemptions for like school fundraisers and things of that nature. Again, though, I don't know how many school fundraisers have kids out in the roads seeking to solicit. I mean, maybe they do. I don't mean to speak down. I just don't know.
Let me ask you, when we started this, again, you said a couple of things that I agree with and a couple I have concerns with.
Okay.
Number one, I thought the sheriff was looking for some type of mechanism to ensure the safety of these people. When we start looking at the, are they with a reputable charity and are they supposed to be collecting money and all that, I'm not sure that's a responsibility we need to be undertaking. I understand the safety aspect of it, but for government to verify that they're with a reputable organization, I think that's an overreach.
If I could only respectfully say that I'm not suggesting reputable, but I would be suggesting that they comply with the state law regarding being registered as a charitable organization. And just as an aside, you know, we already have a solicitor and canvassing ordinance. Now, to be fair, that has to do with people knocking on the door of your front of your home. So a significant degree of additional intrusion that doesn't exist probably out in the common right of way. So I can't disagree with that.
What the sheriff asked for is some mechanism to ensure the safety.
I think they should register. I think they should have the name of the organization they say they're claiming to be collecting for. I don't know how in the world we want to create additional staff downstairs to start making phone calls and confirming that what they're turning in is legitimate to begin with.
If they want to sign an affidavit, I think that's
it wouldn't be the way I have this structured. Is this would go through support, the support division. They would be entitled to assess a reasonable fee to reflect their administrative cost of checking, and it should be as easy as going to a database with the Secretary of State and find out if they're a registered 501c3 organization.
As long as you're not going so deep, then you start finding that person's even part of that and making phone calls
and charging fee.
Hey, this is just this is just for discussion.
Fees for charitable organization, right? Yeah. Collecting charity. I mean, it was 501c3 for some ball team, Shriners. I just don't see us trying to tag onto their money.
He said we had some exemptions built into the code originally.
No, but he just said that the support services can charge, and I'm sure it's in here, charge a reasonable fee. You know, we can't keep expanding what government does. We just can't. We've got another way that our tenants are reaching into everything people do. I just can't hold on to it.
If we do this, then we make it the sheriff's responsibility to do the permitting if he wants so bad.
Well, we have to create the ordinance for him to enforce.
That's correct.
Well, that's what it says. It says the Forsyth County Sheriff's Office Support Division is authorized to prepare applications for the implementation of this section.
You can say no fee or 50 cents or a dollar or no fee.
It just seems to go a lot further than what the sheriff told me it was about. He told me about, okay, we got people out in the intersection of Marketplace and Highway 20. They're concerned about the safety of these people. They want to have a mechanism to be able to enforce the safety. We're into enforcing a 501c3 and registered with the Secretary of State. They're going to charge a fee. They've got to get a permit, put a sign on it.
We've got some down in McFarland and 9, McFarland near 400, have homeless handwritten signs up.
And let me just put my two cents in from the legal aspect of it. I don't want to be into the guaranteeing of safety. But I don't think there's any way that's a win for the county. I don't see how we even do that. I mean,
then what are we then?
When I spoke to the sheriff, and I forgive me for him not being here, I wish that, it's my fault, I should have invited him specifically to this, but when I spoke to him, what I carried away was, is he was looking for a way to be able to easily identify whether or not they were legitimately a part of an organization or not by way of some sort of a ID tag. And if y'all have no interest in doing that, there's...
I do, but I just don't feel like you want to add a fee on them. I just can't see how you can take a charitable organization and government step in and want a piece of what they're collecting. I'm not part of that, but I'm okay with them going in and signing a little affidavit, filling a little short form, sign affidavit, and then give them a little... fluorescent card just kind of bright color or something, and away they go.
Well, the situation there is, for some reason, let me back up. Would this be fine with you if everybody did it? Commercial organizations, political protests, parades?
No, because the bottom line is 501(c)(3) is fine. I don't know if anyone wants to go to the whole investigation.
Well, what if they lie?
C3, they might be C7.
What if they're not, and they say they are?
I don't think anybody and everybody should just be able to go on the street when they can't.
I think there's some questions from citizens, too, about some of these charitable, are really people collect money for charity.
That's correct. That's why they should have the organization. I think someone's actually coming into the police, sheriff's office, and there's a deputy standing there getting to sign a form, and they're swearing that this is accurate. I don't think you would come in line with that form.
Yeah. Do you have an idea, or can you offer some inside idea? There was a form that they went to support services, kind of like a demonstration permit. They go in, I need to get a permit, I'm going to be collecting some money over there at Marketplace or Castleberry or whatever. Yes, sir, if you'll just fill out this form with your name, address, phone number, contact information. Who are you collecting for? Here you go, here's your permit. Off you go. And that relieves us of the, and in signing that, they also relieve us of any safety issues. Instead of this cumbersome, again, I know you did what you think the sheriff wanted and maybe what we asked for, but I can't continue to add to what we do and what we're responsible for checking on and insuring and guaranteeing and monitoring and ticketing.
Is that sound good for you?
Well,
but the ticketing process, you have to have it.
No, no, but you know what I mean. You know what I mean.
I want to address the problem, and what I'm hearing the problem is you don't like the fee. Okay, that's we can strike that.
And an affidavit is fine. I don't know the affidavit. Yeah. You put down what your organization is, that you're a charitable organization, or you're collecting for one, and sign an affidavit and swear to your signature, and you're done.
But so now my question is, and so now where are you?
Well, they get the little placard that says that they're registered with the sheriff's office.
From who?
From the sheriff's office. Support services. Yeah.
They're going to make these placards, and we're going to get in the business of flying 100 of them every weekend.
Well, I don't think there's any people.
They could use
if there are.
Pink fluorescent paper.
There are.
What if there are?
But you know there's not. You're saying if is, I mean, come on.
If I'm just talking about Nydia, we're talking about another expense to the county. We're talking about us flying a piece of string and somebody doing all this. I mean, it winds up costing us money.
So you want to charge a dollar for it?
Well, I don't know, but I mean, a fee could be a dollar.
Well,
I mean, you talk about
$1. My feeling is I don't know what any of this is getting of us. Again, I think
the sheriff
talked about safety first. That was the issue. We're now addressing all kinds of things that, as far as I can hear, don't have anything whatsoever to do with safety.
That's what's all that's in here. Yeah. I mean, I'm with you. Yeah. We need to only ensure that they're registered so that it gives the deputies an opportunity to go up to them and say, Mr. Smith, you're out here, or who are you, and why are you wandering around in the middle of Highway 20? Well, I'm collecting money. No, sir, you can't do that. You need to go register. But it gives them a mechanism to talk to them and ensure that they're not panhandlers, I guess.
But a panhandler can go and get the thing.
Sure, they should be.
I'm a panhandler.
They
give
can.
Me my
and
ID.
And they might need to show their ID to get it.
And now it's safe?
No, but it's safe.
They don't have any
go in.
No, but they wait a lot.
But they're registered. What corner are you going to go collect on? Which driver's license? They have some ID on this.
They also will. They will also waive their right to. Can claim damages? What's the?
Well, I mean, I would hope to draft the form such that it contains an exemption that we're not guaranteeing their safety, but I mean,
if let government get involved.
It is what happens. I don't think that
we're going to have a whole division responsible for monitoring, registering, and monitoring.
We've got the charitable institutions to panhandlers then.
What you got there, sir? Well, he has a, he already has his card. He's got,
yeah, he's got a Panhandle card.
That's great.
Ken, I do feel like there's something we, that, thank you for this, all this work and talking to the sheriff. I just feel like somehow we are missing something, and I'm not really sure what the thing is that we're missing.
Well, I mean, you all have every right to simply take a look at an initiative and pass on it.
I tend to agree, except that I would love to hear however he would like to present it to us in an email or a presentation. The sheriff to sort of
respect when we come back.
Give us the nudge in the direction that he's really shooting at.
Or don't allow him out there at all.
I don't see how you regulate safety that way. I mean, unless we get into the business of cordoning off particular areas of the intersection and putting safe zones, I mean, I don't see how you get into safety. That's going to be difficult for me.
Let me ask you this, except for the exceptions that we already have, is there no definition isn't the definition of jaywalking is if you're on the street, not in the crosswalk area?
I think technically.
Huh?
I think technically, which is why this code section particularly allows, the state law particularly allows us to authorize charitable organizations to solicit contributions in the roadway. Remember the law catching up with what actually happens.
Are they prohibited from doing it right now?
Arguably.
Is this something?
Arguably
okay,
they are.
So let's go back. Is this something that we could just have as a website? You go to the website, perhaps. You type in your name and your organization, and you hit print, and your printer prints it out, and you stick it on your shirt, and then you're okay.
Yeah, and it emails the registration data to support services.
Does Panhandle have computers?
They go to the library.
They go to the library.
Good idea.
We got great computers.
But I still don't know what we've got from all this. You know, so let's say we do that, and
bureaucracy, Jim.
Well.
I mean, where are we going with this? I didn't want to.
I think we're confused then.
I think we saw postpone it.
Yeah, can we
table.
Do that?
Table. Motion to table this item.
Second.
I don't know about.
We can bring it back.
Yeah.
Sure.
We have a. Go ahead, Ken.
No, well, I mean, okay, a table is that's basically an extinguishment by another name, and that's fine, but is that the message you're going to communicate back to the sheriff? That's perfectly fine, by the way.
I think it's appropriate to tell the sheriff that this is not, that the board is not interested in passing registration, verifications, et cetera. We need to know what he wants us to do to ensure the safety of these people at the intersection.
Speaking of conventions, we'll bring it back.
Yeah. Safety.
What do you want to postpone? Let him come talk.
We just did.
But if you assume for a moment that you can't do it now, you can't legally do it now, and this was a way to allow it to be done lawfully,
then he has to make a decision. We don't enforce laws, he does.
That's correct. I agree with you. Okay.
Hopefully he would enforce the spice law at the convenience stores that's been on the books for a year.
377.
Okay, let's vote on this one.
That's good.
What's the motion?
Table.
Motion is tabled.
Do we have a second? Yeah.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. That passes unanimously. And we are on to item 20, I believe.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, this is just a policy discussion, quite frankly. You know, our alcohol code was modified a couple of years ago to sort of embark on a new paradigm where we not only will issue administrative sanctions against the license holders, but also against the employees. And that has resulted in basically a situation where every alcohol hearing has two components, the sales permit and the licensee. I think historical experience has shown us that a lot of times the employee doesn't show up, the license holder does show up. We go through the same sort of recitation of facts and process for each one. And right now, if we have 8 or 9 of these on our agenda, we're tacking on about 2.5 hours onto our board meetings at night. So I think there was at least a passing issue or interest in would it be possible to reconstruct our alcohol code with at least the alcohol sales permits, these sanctions being subject to administrative distribution. I mean, particularly when you get into a situation like we are routinely out there for underage sales,
the employee will show up, they'll come down, they will discuss why you all ought to go easy on them, and then your alcohol code says no less than 30 days. And so it really doesn't matter what they say, it's not going to be any less. Now, it could be more, but it's not going to be any less, and I have never seen it be more. So would there be an interest in perhaps having community planning and community development have the opportunity on certain of these offenses to simply give out administrative sanctions rather than having them come before you?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yes.
A couple of things I'd like to throw out for discussion.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so right now, if they get a ticket, they're subject to 30-day suspension and a $500 fine.
For underage sales, yes.
No, for underage sales.
Yes.
Now, what if they don't have their, what if there's another violation? What is their other administration violation? Not having their permit?
Yeah. Like not having the permit, more of a technical or administrative infraction?
Does that still come to the Board of Commissioners?
Right now it does, yes.
Okay, that probably shouldn't, I don't think, if it's just an administrative thing. We're interested in if they are selling to, you know, underage kids. That's what we're trying to get involved in. So,
What if they don't have a license and they sell to underage?
Well, then they probably should come to the board.
Is that even illegal?
No, we have one of those license.
Didn't even have a license?
Yeah, he did.
Because he just started being tested.
He was being tested and got caught tonight.
Yeah.
We had neither one of them. But we got to combine them. Ken, our counselor, esteemed counselor, advised us we could combine them as one. He just got started.
But there have been a couple of unique situations where some of these people, you know, we wished we didn't have to give them 30 days and $500 fine. So I think we ought to put on there that if they get tagged, they can appeal the 30 days to the Board of Commissioners. They can come make their case. I mean, they're not going to walk in there and say, hey, I did it, go easy on me.
This is optional. They can do an option.
Yeah, they can either lose it for 30 days and pay the $500 fine, or they can appeal. And if they've got, you know, mitigating circumstances, we can hear them.
I certainly, if I had a $500 fine, I'd appeal every one.
Well, I said the 30 days. I'm sorry.
Well, no, 30 days.
Yeah, they're going to pay the $500 fine.
But we have to change our ordinance code. It's now it's mandatory.
Let's distinguish between what's going on in magistrate court. Magistrate court is where that $500 fine is being imposed.
Why don't we just put upon adjudication of guilt that they have a 30-day suspension unless they want to appeal it to the Board of Commissioners?
That's just what I said. Yeah.
That way they have 30 days to appeal.
That's why they're not losing their job. Because a lot of employers are saying, okay, you did something wrong, I should fire you. But I'm not going to. But now you can't work. Now you can't work in the position I'm hired you for. So I've got to fire you.
Is that for underage sales?
So are you saying to not suspend it for 30 days?
I'm saying if they want to mitigate that, they can come to the Board of Commissioners.
But we have nothing for that now.
But they can go to court, we can change that. They get a $500.
They're going to pay the
30 day suspension.
They're going to pay the $500 fine
and the 30 day suspension.
No, but the 30 day suspension they can either take it at magistrate or they can appeal that to come to the Board of Commissioners and make their case as to.
So it's automatic unless they
appeal. Right, it's automatic unless they appeal it. So they're going to come in and say, look, I wasn't trained, I didn't know better. Since then, I've gone through the TIPS program, I've done this, I've done that, and I made a mistake, and I can't lose my job over it and never happen again. Because some of these people are getting fired immediately.
So you want to change the ordinance?
That's challenging to me, though, because you're talking about appellate right from magistrate court coming to the board.
No.
No.
You're not.
Now, if I may.
Sure.
Upon adjudication of the $500 fine by magistrate.
Yes.
They've got 30 days to come in to our office to file that they want to come actually see the Board of Commissioners.
If they don't,
30 days after adjudication, it'll automatically go into suspension. But they've got 30 days to come in to fill out whatever forms to come see us at our next hearing. Otherwise, it's 30 days. We don't start the 30 days at the 30-day mark. Give them the opportunity to come see us first.
Okay, so the magistrate court will be imposing its traditional fine.
Yeah. Nothing changes.
Nothing changes.
We use as a trigger for the time frame Give them 30 days to come in to fill out a form.
In 30 days, the suspension starts.
Yep. I just need to make sure that Magistrate Court is communicating with community development quick enough, though.
Right.
I mean, for instance, you know, when y'all see these things, how old are they? They're like 7 months old.
Yeah, they are.
So are we getting information from the Magistrate Court quick enough to...
I don't know how long it takes.
Well, not only that, what's the person do during that, let's say, 7 months? Is their license...
They're doing the same thing they're doing now, which is serving alcohol.
That's correct. So you give them a time frame, whatever that time frame is, to fill out.
And so 7 months later, they finally see us and we say, now we're going to take away your license?
That's what's happening now.
That's what's happening now. It ought to trigger 30-day suspension. I like Todd's idea. 30 days after you leave court, your 30-day suspension starts.
Unless...
You've come in and requested an appeal before the Board of Commissioners at the next public hearing, you request administrative hearing.
What if they appeal and the paperwork hadn't got here? Can't say what the magistrate court had.
They know when they leave magistrate court that they're going
to... We'll have to manage that. That's all.
Yeah, that's the thing. Call up and case number for someone. So
wait, can I say it slightly different? I go to magistrate court. I'm found guilty. I do nothing.
In 30 days.
I do nothing. At the end of 30, I do nothing. I can... Since I did nothing, my license is suspended when I walk out of, not by magistrate court, but it's suspended immediately.
30 days.
Immediately.
If you're saying that,
appeal,
okay.
Then you won't have a hearing.
Unless I appeal.
Okay. But you gotta have a certain...
And at the end of 30 days, I can go, if I don't do anything, I can go get another permit.
Well, somebody's gotta tell you.
You gotta have 30 days.
You have to have a window to get some paperwork transferred.
Let them come in. If they're in court this morning at 10 a.m. and found guilty,
okay, because under my thing, it might take me a day or two to file the appeal, and I've lost my license immediately.
Yes. And most appeals are 30 days, is it not? Most appeals are given 30 days.
So they get a 30-day appeal.
And that would cause my employer to fire me because I just instantly lost the license. Yeah. This is an appeal, which is what you're trying to...
In 30 days, I'm going to be suspended. You need to arrange my schedule.
Okay.
Depending on who you work for.
It's a 30-30 rule, we'll call it.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, y'all have been acting under the underage sale. What about just technical violations? Same rule?
Technical violations, I don't think need to come to the Board of Commissioners at all.
Say the same thing.
What?
Is there a suspension on technical? What is the...
There can be. Yeah, you can. Typically do not.
That's optional.
What is the penalty for a technical violation?
It's like 7 to 10 days.
Okay, then why don't we make them pay the fine and not have to come to us unless it's their second violation?
Yes, there is.
On a technical. On the technical.
I would like that too.
Because if they're not getting the message, certainly they're getting the message. What they don't know, and a lot of them are, you know, getting to know it, is that if you get caught selling, you have a $500 fine coming.
Yes.
That's a surprise to a lot.
That's a shock.
But once what happens to one of them, in the business,
they share that.
They're all over.
They share,
you know, I get it. I got it. I've got a card, or I'm going to pay $500. No ifs, no ands, no buts.
It's a lot of money to me.
Because
that's not. Thank you. What?
I didn't hear that either.
Chevy.
What I'm hearing then is underage sales, guilty or plea of guilty at magistrate court. 30 days later, we will commence an administrative suspension of their license,
right,
unless they tender an appeal.
To come to the Board of Commissioners to explain and try to mitigate their circumstances. Look, this is what I did, or, you know, because there have been a couple of...
But then we're going to change this one, which is mandatory.
That's right.
Yeah.
But they're going to pay the fine. They're going to pay the fine.
And is there any way for magistrate court to hand them a form upon the adjudication, it's a also, you know, you,
here's
so
the,
at least they have this to hand, they know.
In 30 days,
right
you're
then and there,
unless you go.
They walk right across the street right then and fill it if they want to or not.
Yeah, we can do that. My attorneys can do that. We can just
get a handable form right then and there.
And then the technical side, if they just pay the fine on the first time and go about their business, they don't need to come in.
They don't need to come to the Board of Commissioners.
But a second technical infraction,
a second
in
24 months, then they come in and say, why is it not important enough to you to go get a license, and why is your employer allowing you to work without one? Because because if they get one, then their employer's getting one too, right?
Yes.
They're getting a citation.
And on the second underage sale,
so
we just leave it like it is.
Yeah.
And can I ask you that if there are mixed administrative and underage, that the one with the most severe sanction is the procedure that controls?
Sounds reasonable.
Right?
Sure.
Okay.
But they pay both fines.
Right. I agree.
Can we, on the second underage sale violation. It says within a 24-month period, it results in a mandatory hearing before the Board of Commissioners. Mm-hmm. It's also a fine of $750 and a $75 reinstatement fee. Mm-hmm. Would the Board consider something that if they don't show up, it's a, you know, how do we communicate to them, number one, that a mandatory hearing means in case they don't quite understand that?
Attendance of the hearing should be required.
Can you put that in in this, that a mandatory hearing at which?
Failure to attend or to appear shall result in X.
Immediate arrest and
well, probably can't go quite there.
It'll need to be on the
form that they... You'll be required to collect charitable money at the...
If they have a form they sign, when they get their license, they fill out something so they understand if this happens.
Can we make them wear a dog tag?
No.
Why?
It's a swell.
You must have to wear one.
Are we Dutch Council?
Yes, sir. I've got your directive.
Okay. Are we on to items 21?
Save the poor people.
Yes, I'm going to talk
about sure.
Release and settlement agreement, Counselor.
Mr. Chairman, members of the Board, this is a claim that was brought to Forsyth County. I've been discussing it with Charity Clark and our insurance carrier, ACCG. It arises out of, quite frankly, a factual dispute at an equestrian center where there was a dispute between the boarder of the horse and the owner of the facility of the stable. Forsyth County deputies were called out to the center and allowed the horses to leave the facility. The allegation being made by the owner of the stable is that because the boarder of the horses was late in their rent, they had a right to basically require the horses stay on the premises, not unlike a mechanic's lien. We have received allegations of a threat to litigate based upon these facts, and we have an offer to settle the case for $4,000. Folks, in light of the fact that it'll cost more than $4,000 to get the machinery of litigation cranked up and the facts are at least disputed and there is at least a statute which does give some credence to the allegations by the plaintiff, my recommendation is that we do settle it for $4,000. ACCG is already on board with that. I'm bringing it to you simply to get your permission.
Ken, this is just a detailed question about it. Is the situation that the police should not have allowed the horses to leave, or that they did, or that they got involved at all, or what?
That's the argument. The argument is that the deputies were there to keep the peace and were endeavoring to keep the peace, and by the time they got there, the horses were already basically in a state of being taken from the property. And I think the deputy, if my position is, and again, I hope it settles because this is my theory on the case. My position is that if the horses had been in the stable and had been behind closed doors, I think that's the status quo they would have preserved. But because they were already being transported off the property to keep the peace, they allowed them to continue to be transported off the property, and that's the status quo they preserved.
Do you think they got in the middle of a civil matter when they maybe they should have been?
I think they had little choice but to get involved in the civil matter. But your point is well taken, nonetheless. And it's a very difficult situation for them as they're attempting to make. You know, I can make them after reviewing the law for a few hours and deciding what I would do. They're asked to make the decision in real time. They made it. I think there's a close enough call that I can recommend payment of this amount. At the full rate, they're maintaining a little over $6,000 to $7,000.
Huh? That's how much they were owed at the time?
That's the allegation.
Here's the interesting part. In one of them, one of them proved their damages by and way the horses were able to leave, and they couldn't hold on to them, I guess, to resell them, to regain their
ostensibly, it's leverage to get their rent paid.
There is Georgia code that allows it.
I know, but the fact isn't, unless they're very valuable horses, I just don't see where that holds anything. I understand you got to sell cattle if you don't close up your door. Next thing you know, you got horses in there because people can't afford to keep horses nowadays.
The problem is, does the county want to pay $10,000 to find out if we're right?
I can't believe I'd like to make a stand.
Your point's a good one.
Motion that we authorize $4,000 for the settlement agreement through the county attorney.
Second.
And ACCG is going to pay the entire $4,000?
They will not. This will come out of our self-insured retention.
Sheriff's budget, sheriff's legal budget.
That'll be with Charity Clark, and I'll see how she probably, so I'm not sure. It's a major matter of her budget, quite frankly.
I think we have a motion and second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. We're on to item number 22.
She's on camera now.
Stand up, Tim.
Get back if you're going
to come in. You're going to give me a ride home?
I give you a ride home.
She's walking home now.
Item number 22, lease for secure space, county manager.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, this is, as it states, lease for secure space for the sheriff's
office. Let me interrupt just for a second. I'd just like to make sure that what we're talking about is an undisclosed location, and we would like to make keep it that way.
Yes, sir. It is, documents that are in your book with respect to the lease agreement have been redacted, and because of that, the location is undisclosed. We are currently in a lease for this space for the sheriff's office. It started in 2008. It expires April 30th of 2012. The new lease agreement that you have in your booklets is for the same space. It is 1 year renewable. 1 year renewables through 2017. Public facilities and legal have reviewed this. I have also spoken with the sheriff's office, and the space continues to work for him and will continue to work for him. And the recommendation to this board is to simply renew the lease as shown in your books.
Is there an increase in the lease over?
Actually, the 2013 rental rate is somewhat lower than the 2012 rental rate. However, you'll see in the lease agreement that it does escalate $1,200 annually, and you'll see that on page one. But the initial rate going in 2013 is lower than what we paid in 2012.
Do I hear a motion?
Second. Motion to approve lease is presented.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed, like sign. Did that, I believe that passed unanimously.
Yes.
And we are then on to item number 23. Director of Planning and Community Development.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, and Chairman, if you want to, I'll do it.
Yeah.
I'll dive in on this one. This is a matter that was discussed at the last Board of Commissioners meeting, and I think it raised more questions than it resolved, and therefore we brought back to a work session. This pertains to the proposed change of the definition of the septic system under the UDC. When this was originally discussed, it seems like years ago, I guess months ago, the notion was that we would allow, in very limited situations, the installation of on-site septic tank systems where there may have been component parts of the systems, for instance, like the drain field, installed on other lots, which is typically a practice that we don't allow and the Board of Health doesn't like, that we would accommodate that in order to assist a couple of folks that I think there has been some outcry from. To be able to permit their property or permit adjacent property, but that was only going to be allowed if they had a irrevocable access and maintenance easement with respect to that adjacent parcel. Irrevocable access easement with respect to that adjacent parcel. Therefore, they would have their, for instance, their tank on the portion of the property where their home sits, and they might have their leachate field on an adjacent property, and they would be able, by way of their easement, to cross the property boundary and go on there and maintain their system. I believe some concerns were raised at the public hearing with respect to the consequences of this modification. I will tell you that my
recollection, the last time we talked about this in work session was that you all wanted it limited. You wanted a durational requirement put on it. In other words, we didn't want this to be a situation where future builders could look at this as a way to have septic tank components put all over various lots. And I had drafted it such that a cutoff date was January 1st of this year. In other words, if you were going to take advantage of this definition, whatever was in the ground had to have been in the ground before this year. Since that time, folks have come to me and said, well, what if people take advantage of a leachate field that was in fact in the ground before the beginning of this year and a tank that was in the ground before the beginning of this year, but they're not connected now, but someone wants to exploit that, say, loophole and connect them by way of a pipe. Is that a way to get around this? And I hadn't thought of it that way, but perhaps that is a way. My argument, I think, in response to that would be that the installation of the actual pipe would not be permitted. But
you couldn't install the pipe because it wasn't in the ground.
Well, that would be my argument, but I certainly don't want an enterprising attorney or anybody else to be able to make that argument. So I'm open to options or open to see if you have any interest in doing this or open to see if you want us to go a different way. I thought I heard a comment at the public hearing that perhaps we wanted to go back and rope this in to when the UDC was modified, which would be back in the literally the 70s. Or some other time frame. So I'm open to that. I just didn't know.
How do we just protect it against what the fear is somebody just happens upon a leach field and happens upon a tank and wants to hook them up? I mean, how do we?
Well, before we go there, I read quickly, I think it was the case that you originally presented, and I was surprised that in my reading very quickly, I thought I read that initially there was a case where a guy had a house and he had a septic system and it was on one property, and then he subdivided the property and the leach field, let's say, suddenly became on a piece of property because he divided it. And I assume he divided it because he could then pay less taxes on the piece that could not be used for anything other than a leach field, because you couldn't build on it anymore. That's one thing that was a bit of a surprise to me. And the second thing is that what we're discussing now, I think, does not prevent somebody from doing the same thing in the future. That is, starting off with one piece of property, as you normally would, and then dividing that piece of property and declaring, even as we speak, that this piece over here is now a piece of property that's essentially worthless because all it contains is the leach field. That's a bit different than what we were addressing here, but it's...
But you got a good point. You don't want people to divide a lot and intentionally put the drain field on another lot just so they can configure it. But it says here that it's on a lot, individual lot, prior to January 1st, 2012, and that it's on a adjacent lot. It has to be on an adjacent lot prior to January 2012. In that case as well. They can't split it now because it wouldn't meet the code. It has to be two lots prior to January 2012.
Well, here's the thing. How would we know that they split it?
I can't see that they can declare one lot unusable, because that house is unusable without that lot. So that lot's just as valuable. Yeah. With the fill line on it, it's just as valuable.
Not while they're paying taxes.
But they can't split. They can't come in and that would be fraud. If they came in and did that. And people, I mean, you drive 57 miles an hour at 55, you break the law sometimes. Well, that would be intentional.
Has someone done that in
Again, in the very quick reading of the thing that I think brought this up, I thought that's what they said, is for some reason they subdivided the property. If I was going to live in a house my whole life and wasn't thinking about the future's resale value, that may potentially reduce my taxes.
But you can't split it. It would have had to have been split prior to January 2012.
Well, but I can also recombine them later when I go to sell. If I own both properties.
We can't cover every hypothetical.
It doesn't cover it. Unless you have such a large piece of land.
If you command them to do that, then the tax commission wonder, so this land, who's going to say this land is not worth anything? Because it is. It's worth just as much as your house next door, because your house is going to...
Once you subdivide it, it costs more. You've created two building lots and it costs more, not less.
Jim, I know there's an issue in your district, and this doesn't have anything to do with that, and I don't think there's a way that person can utilize this change to their benefit.
don't see that happening.
Well, okay, so what's the latest date we could set this back to and still cover the people who have a phone problem?
January 1st, 2010. We'll be okay.
Why don't we just put it on a specific address and be done with it?
Is 2010 as far back as we can?
Hey, it was my fault, too.
Yeah, well, can we do this in your district?
Go back to 2010.
Hey, specific address.
Don't do an address.
Out there on the...
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know. Where were they at?
I'm talking about the ones that had started out with the property first place. You wanted to set the vision if we allowed.
Yeah, I mean, I can argue, yeah, this affects one guy in my district, but the whole discussion affected one guy in somebody else's district.
Well, no, we want to make sure that it doesn't allow people to do something we don't want. We're just trying to fix where somebody has really innocently run into a problem that renders their house impossible to get clear title.
Yeah, unsellable, can't get it.
It's not, I don't want to do anything to jeopardize. I know that you have some constituents that are disagreeing on an issue. I think there's support, there's some litigation involved. This was brought up for that, and I don't want this to be able to be used by either party. Now, there's not what it's intended for. So, and so it wasn't drafted to allow those parties, either one of them, to. It's specifically for the one person. I think 2010 would cover.
You think so, Ken?
2009.
I don't know the specific dates of these other individuals, but I have no problem with it being further back than 2012 at all. If you all want me to tighten this down such that it's very, very clear that not only the tank, but none of the component parts, none of the connections, nothing can be installed after 2010.
Does that work for you? Work?
I can do that.
Sure. It has to be a complete system prior to, right?
Yes.
Is that right?
Now, what happens if this person has to upgrade your system because the lines fail or something? Are they allowed to do that on the other lot, or is that, I mean, how does that come up with?
They're supposed to have secondary fields permitted anyway.
Okay, as long as they're covered, you see what I'm saying? Yeah. Issue again later.
That's how we get.
How long has that been true to be for a long time that you had to have a secondary?
Oh, yeah.
Years.
Okay. That's why they've had to combine some lots and smaller subdivisions to even get a building permit because we changed the roof on.
So can you can make it where it has to be a complete system prior to. I can get a date for you if you like to really hammer it down, and we can put it between such and such a date.
That's what I'd like. Well,
and I'm comfortable with that.
I mean, yeah, that's what I'd like to see.
Yeah, I'll get you some dates, kid. Why don't we just put a tax book?
Okay, just give me some additional information. I'll bring it back to you at the next public hearing.
I'll get it for you.
Thank you. Okay, 24, Oxford Sewer Reservation Agreement, I think.
You want to postpone that?
No.
Why?
No. That was not funny.
I was just seeing if you were awake.
No, I wasn't. I'm
awake.
2 hours and 15 minutes later.
Was he?
Just want to see if you were paying attention.
He's on fire. Tim, do you need a couple?
Thank you.
Tim.
Yes.
Got it. Thank you.
Board members, this next item was added by way of supplementing the agenda this evening. As I mentioned in the back of the packet I just handed out to you, you will see a October 25th, I think I said when I was adding this to the agenda in November, but it's October 25th, letter of intent. From Forsyth County to Bill Hargett at Oxford Forsyth Development LLC. It was a letter of intent for sewer capacity. What you have in front of you is a standard Forsyth County sewer reservation agreement. There's nothing terribly unusual about this at all. However, where all of the numbers are supposed to be, it simply asks that you go back to the addendum in the rear of the agreement, which is here. It's the short couple paragraphs in the very back. And it provides that as follows. This development consists of two phases. Pursuant to the letter of intent, Oxford is hereby purchasing and reserving 21,000 gallons per day of sewage treatment capacity at a price of $399,000 for the first phase of 141 units. So that's what this agreement, from a nuts and bolts perspective, is actually doing, and that equates to $19 per gallon. Tim, is that the prevailing rate out there?
Yes.
All right, so they're buying it at the prevailing rate of $19 per gallon. And then regarding the second phase, which contemplates 25,800 gallons per day for 172 units, no such capacity shall be considered reserved until same is paid at the county's then current applicable rate. And then otherwise, you have to look at the letter of intent. Remember, this is where we're talking about, Tim, catch me on this, multifamily, and we're embarking on a little bit of a different paradigm where we are allowing a little bit of a less purchase of the capacity, but we're doing more aggressive monitoring with the right to go back and ask for supplemental purchases of capacity if certain benchmarks are satisfied. And so this is sort of a case of first impression, and this is the way we're going to try and do this and see if we can, you know, work out a way we're not requiring multifamily to buy just like they're a detached unit in a subdivision is what we're literally doing. If it works, it works, and you know, Tim's office will be able to monitor it. And if it doesn't work, they bought too little, then we'll make them buy more.
Tim, you happy with this?
Yes.
Do I hear a motion from the board? Is there any discussion?
So, encumber future owners.
Yes.
Sure, reservation agreement presented by the county.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye. Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed?
I watch.
All those opposed, like sign. That passes unanimously.
I was like for.
We're on to item number 25, initiating a rezoning, including the Buckhorn property and others.
Mr. Chairman, at this time, I'd like to accuse myself again. Yeah.
You get to leave early.
No.
We
have dinner ready.
Do we have executive session?
We do.
Of course. We'll leave the room at this time. I'll be back and walk over to Tam's. Hammer restaurant.
Is that a promotion?
Hammer L.
Roundabout.
We're charging for water over there.
Gotcha.
Don't
know that's up there.
Buford Tam's.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, this next item is a request for the county to initiate a rezoning on a piece of property owned by Mashburn Farms LP and the James Mashburn Trust, consisting of 228 acres. It is directly adjacent to the Buckhorn sand mine operation up in the northern part of the county. Mr. Chairman, this issue arises out of a county zoning of the sand mine operation. You may remember that in order to resolve, quite frankly, a host of different cases involving Buckhorn, the county zoned property up there to sort of, I believe it was characterized as sort of a green or environmental campus concept. And the zoning of that property resulted in a challenge by an adjacent property owner, as is their right. And so what we're endeavoring to resolve now is that litigation, which is Mashburn Trust and Mashburn Farms versus Forsyth County as the zoning entity and Buckhorn Ventures as the property owner. All right, we think we have a resolution that will work, and that resolution is to rezone the property, the 228 acres owned by Mashburn Farms and Mashburn Trust, to from a Res 4, which is the current zoning designation, to a Res 6, which would allow multifamily development at a density of 6 units per acre with a maximum of up to 1,000 units on this piece of property. And you may recall one of the reasons for this rezoning was to allow sort of the consolidation of the density away from the bluff overlooking the sand mine operation and sort of bringing the development more internal to the piece of property itself. This would be part of a settlement agreement. I wish I could tell you that I absolutely have sign off by every party to the settlement agreement. I don't, but the expectation would be that we would have a settlement agreement by the time that we actually get around to actual zoning of the property. I will further tell you that even if we initiate the rezoning under the auspices of settling the case, you don't have to zone it this way. You're not agreeing to zone it any particular way, and you retain your full legislative discretion on the issue of zoning as you must.
Okay.
under Georgia law. But the first step is under our rules, Rule 1.08.06, is for you to give me the authorization to initiate in the first place, and then I will set the wheels in motion. I'll get with Tom Brown, we'll begin to run legal ads. And this is a very accelerated process, though. Remember, this will be one public hearing and it's done. And that's the way a county initiated process works, which is why we have to do it this way here at the work session.
Mr. Chairman, based on that presentation, I'd like to make a motion that we instruct the county attorney to begin the county initiated rezoning process on the terms you described. The first public hearing, the first and only public hearing to be held at the May public hearing.
Second. Any discussion? We have a motion and a second. If there is no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. There are none. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Amos having recused himself. That brings us to the end of our agenda. Council, do we have a need of an executive session?
We do, sir.
You do?
Yes, sir.
Do I hear a motion to adjourn this meeting and enter into executive session for the purpose of litigation, personnel, and land acquisition?
At 4:30.
And we'll start at 4:30? Is that part of the motion?
Yeah.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
That passes 4-0. We are adjourned at 4:21.
You know what? She thought.